This is WKTV Voices, 9/11 at 20, Our Islamic Neighbors 20 Years Later. This special WKTV Voices project will present interviews covering a range of personal stories of the 9/11 attacks and their impact over the following two decades, with background interviews dealing with American Islamic history, global politics, and the current Islamic world. We will hear the voices of local Muslim community leaders and, finally, Muslim American citizens, especially young people who grew up in the age of 9/11. Today, we welcome into our studio Dr. Abdullah F. Alrebh, a Grand Valley State University professor whose field of study is sociology of religion and sociological theory. He has published a number of academic articles and essays focusing on religion, the Middle East, and its social movements, and education. He is also very knowledgeable about the Arabian Peninsula region and specifically Saudi Arabia, a country forever linked to the 9/11 terrorist attacks as the plan's leader, Osama bin Laden, who was the initial leader of the pan-Islamic militant organization Al-Qaeda, was a Saudi. Thank you for being with us today, sir.
Thank you, Ken, and it's my pleasure to be with you.
Very good. My introduction was an incredibly oversimplified summary of the attacks of 9/11. So to begin, can you give us a little history of America's relationship with Saudi Arabia, with the Islamic world as a whole, and how that led to Osama bin Laden, to Al-Qaeda, and to that fateful day 20 years ago?
Okay, you are asking about a huge story. Let me try to summarize it in the best way I can. First of all, American history with Islamic world, particularly Saudi Arabia, start in positive way. So if you compare United States of America compared with Great Britain, UK, or France, or other European countries, United States was not a colonial power. It's a good start. So yes, United States might involve by its military in other parts of the world, Vietnam, Korea, Filipino, but not in Middle East. So this one fact, another fact, the repetition about United States is a religious country. So people with faith. So Middle Eastern people, most of them are Muslims with the minority of Christians, they have faith. So they respect each other. So when the Second World War done, President Franklin Roosevelt was visiting Egypt and he asked for meeting King Abdulaziz ibn Saud, as known as Ibn Saud, to discuss the relationship with him. And here we go. The story starts in this way. King Abdulaziz met him in the Red Sea, in one of those big boats, and they start to discuss the future of the relationship. And Ibn Saud in that time was looking for a new partnership rather than the old one with Great Britain. Before that, the American oil companies start to dig for oil in Saudi Arabia, and they found the oil late of 1930s. So the friendship or partnership between Saudi Arabia and United States of America start. And Saudi Arabia is an important country for Muslims people. We have the two holy cities, Mecca and Al-Madinah, which all people look for today in Islamic world, and the partnership in fighting the communism, all the mutual interest between two nations start late 30s and early 40s, and they stay forever.
Okay. So the as the late 80s and 90s, there was an oil embargo, there was some tensions between Middle East Arab countries and the West, but there was nothing quite so direct against America up until the Well, there was a bombing of a ship, of a U.S. Navy ship, the Cole, I believe. But the 9/11 was that. I mean, that seemed to be the first direct attack by Islamic militants on the United States. And why did it happen then? I mean, how did Osama bin Laden turn radical? How did Al-Qaeda start, and why did they target America?
Yes, when we talk about those old events such as oil embargo, it was about disagreement between Saudi Arabia and other Muslim countries with American policy in Middle East, especially the unconditional support of Israel. Okay, Israel is killing people in Palestine and attacking neighbors, especially in Lebanon, and the United States would never hold the state of Israel accountable of anything. But it didn't cause any major issue. Okay, oil embargo was 3 days to 1 month, no more than that. But let's come to what happened in 1980s. And I think, Ken, you are old enough to remember the stories, in newspaper stories, where Mujahideen and term jihad was a positive term. First of all, Osama bin Laden and all Mujahideen in Afghanistan were American product. We cannot deny that. So in that time, there was something called Reagan Doctrine, or President Reagan Doctrine in fighting communism. So Reagan was fighting Soviet Union and communism, and Muslims were anti-communism because it's in that time it used to be equal to being atheist. So when Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan, it was a good project for President Reagan administration to mobilize people in Middle East to go to fight in Afghanistan. So let those people go to fight my enemy, and that's it. On the other hand, Islamists or some Islamic militia in Egypt and Saudi Arabia were battering governments. They sieged the Holy Mosque in Mecca in 1979. Mm-hmm. They assassinate President of Egypt, President Sadat. So it was a mutual interest between United States and Middle Eastern countries to fight Soviet Union. And that's what happened. And we have many videos we can watch in YouTube today. We see President Reagan receive those Mujahideen in White House as heroes. So that's what happened. Then, when Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait in 1990, Mujahideen just came back to their countries with the whole bride to be received as heroes. What happened is this: Osama bin Laden went to meet King Fahd and Prince Sultan bin Abdulaziz, former defense minister, and asked them to let him and his group fighting Saddam Hussein, just like what they did in Afghanistan against the Soviet Union. They tried to convince him what happened with in Afghanistan with the Soviet Union is completely different compared with what would happen in Kuwait against Saddam Hussein. Militia fighting, street fighting, would never work with Saddam Hussein. This is not Afghanistan. There is no mountain in Kuwait. He felt that his bride being targeted, and he took it very personal. And then he started to mobilize people. On the same time, people who've been affected by what we call sahwa, reviving of some Islamists who've been inspired by Muslim Brotherhood ideas after they came to Saudi Arabia, and how we should make Saudi Arabia a real Islamic country that not been associated with superpowers such as United States. That's what happened. So then they start to target American interest and Saudi formal institutions in Saudi Arabia. President Clinton react in aggressive way. Then Osama bin Laden and his group end up with planning to attack America in its heart, and that's what happened. And it was really unfortunate for us as Saudis to find 15 out of 19 are Saudis. Mm-hmm. It was shocked for everybody.
So to sort of wrap up this history, is it oversimplification or a stretch to say that the U.S. support of the Mujahideen planted the seed of what Osama bin Laden and al-Qaeda became?
Absolutely, absolutely. Before that, before Afghan war, Osama bin Laden was just a religious businessman, religious young businessman. Ayman al-Zawahiri, the second guy in al-Qaeda, was a religious physician in Egypt, okay? But what happened in the United States bring their dream about being fighters, holy warriors, mujahideen, to be true. When you train them for 10 years and mobilize them against infidels, you need to know infidels is something beyond communists and Soviet Union. Infidels are people who attack Islam, and for them, sending over 200 thousands of soldiers to Arabian Peninsula is invasion for them. Despite if it's right or wrong, but you cannot convince them as fighters that bringing over 200,000 fighters to their country as just assistant. In addition, Iraq is a Muslim country.
Right.
So that's what happened.
Very good. Moving away from that terrible day, 9/11, for a moment, I want to catch up with you. Please tell us a little about your history. Where were you born? How did you come to the United States? How did you make it to GVSU in your position?
Yeah, I born in September 1977 in a small town called Awamiya in city of Katif in the eastern region of Saudi Arabia. I studied in my hometown until I finished my high school. Then I moved to the capital city of Saudi Arabia, Riyadh, and I studied for my BA, bachelor degree in Arabic literature. That time I was happy studying poetry, grammar, and all these things. Then I graduated with my BA in Arabic, and I started working as an Arabic teacher in several parts of Saudi Arabia. In that time, I earned my master's degree from Riyadh, from King Saudi University, in Arabic literature as well. In 2005, King Abdullah gave the nation the greatest gift that my generation would dream about, which is his program of scholarship. I came to the United States in 2007, studying English as second language here in Grand Valley,
really?
In ELS.
Mm-hmm.
And in that time, I was really sad that Grand Valley didn't have a grad program fit with my ambitions. So I moved to East Lansing, and I complete my English language program there. I get admission from Department of Sociology. It was a dream for me. Michigan State admitted me. Then I did my second master in Sociology of Religion. I compared Calvinist Protestantism with Wahhabi Islam. Then I did my PhD dissertation in the media coverage of Saudi Arabia or Saudi Authority. I did some discourse analysis on London Times and New York Times coverage of Saudi Arabia from 1901 to 2005. And then I work as an adjunct here and there until I end up with getting a tenure track position at Grand Valley State University in 2016, and it was a pleasure that to get back to Grand Rapids after 9 years. I left Grand Valley while I was barely writing a sentence in English. Now I get back after writing thousands of pages. I'm really happy and grateful for that.
Very good, very good. Returning a little bit to the fall of 2001, where were you on that day, 9/11? How did it and its after effects impact you and the people around you?
Yeah, in that time, I was a high school teacher and graduate student at King Saud University, in Riyadh. We are 7 hours ahead of Washington time zone, which means it was afternoon. Mm-hmm. I was taking a nap after getting back from school, and in that day I didn't have classes. In that time we didn't have smartphones, I just have my cell phone next to me. I woke up, tons of text message, tons of missed calls. I didn't know what happened. I returned back the call. My friends told me, and my cousins, Abdullah, we are facing the Third World War. It's a disaster. A terrorist attack in New York and Washington there. Is there anything happening in Riyadh? I just changed my clothes and go to Riyadh streets. Nothing happened. I stuck on the TV. Everybody was shocked in that time.
Okay, I guess as we start wrapping this up, I you are a teacher of many interests, religion, society, Islam, the Islamic world. You deal with students at GVSU, both Muslim and non-Muslim. What do you tell them if they ask you about 9/11, what it means? What do you tell those students?
It is part of the unfortunate events in the history, but it is not the only one. Wars, conflict is everywhere, and there is no excuse to take anyone's life in this world. And September 11 is part of larger story. It's not the story itself. It's part of the savage ambitions of some politicians who want to control large part of the world, either if they were officials or militias people. After 20 years of September 11, we should understand this violence would never solve the problem. Look, George W. Bush reaction, destroying Afghanistan and Iraq and creating another tension zones in the world. Look, the feeling, insecure feeling in American airports and the rest of the world airports. People told me here in the United States before September 11, nobody asked you to take off your shoes, nobody asked you. You could easily ask to take a picture with the pilot during the trip. This is the actual loss that we have today, feeling secure. And unfortunately, this is affect not only this affects not only people in the United States, it affects everywhere. I want to tell those young people who can hold our dreams for future, love each other. If you don't love each other, at least don't hit each other. If you really think you really need to hit people, keep your feeling in your mind and do not transfer it to be action, because feeling could be fixed one day, but action, murdering and hurting others would never be fixed. And you might feel sorry, or you might make somebody else feel sorry. It doesn't worth it. Life is too short. Enjoy your life and forget about harming others. Make yourself happy. And if you think somebody gonna go to hell, good for them. Work on yourself and your own salvation, and forget about sending people to hell earlier.
Very good. Well, we want to thank you very much for your time, for visiting WKTV, for giving us the background for this project that we're doing. And once again, we appreciate your time and your opinion on this, sir.
Thank you so much, Ken, and I really appreciate giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts with you.
Very good. This is WKTV Voices, 9/11 at 20, Our Islamic Neighbors 20 Years Later. I'm Ken Norris. For more video interviews and online print stories in this series, visit wktvjournal.org. If you have a story to tell us, contact me at ken@wktv.org. Peace be with you.
Hi, this is Tom from WKTV Journal, encouraging you to subscribe to the WKTV Journal YouTube page right there, and also click the notification bell right there every time you want to be notified about a new community event happening with your community news source, the WKTV Journal.